Now it's on. But okay, so I start now. First, I want to thank the organizers for the opportunity for me to come here and to take part in this very nice workshop in this very nice city. So I will talk about Bernoulli convolutions. And I first tell you what they are. So fix a real number between 0 and 1. And let xi0, xi1, etc. be a sequence of unbiased independent random signs, so plus minus one valued random variables, and then the Bernoulli convolution nu lambda is the law of the random power series I goes from 0 to infinity, lambda to the I times xi I. Because lambda is less than 1, this always converges, so this gives you a random number on the real line, and it has a law, it is the Bernoulli convolution. So even if you don't recognize it, you have probably seen this measure, because if lambda is less than 1 half, then this is a measure supported on a Cantor set and it is often called the Devious staircase. So that's the most common example for a singular measure. So if lambda is less than 1 half, then this measure is singular. If lambda is equals to 1 half, then nu lambda is Lebesgue on, I think, minus 2, 2. This you can easily show. So this is absolutely continuous. And what is interesting is what happens when lambda is bigger than 1/2. So that's still not understood. But it turns out that it depends on lambda. So it can be singular and it can be absolutely continuous. So first, a simple observation. Is that if you look at nu kth root of minus kth root of 2, then this is equal to nu 1/2 convolved with another measure. And you can see this simply by looking at the definition and separating every kth term in this power series will give you the law of nu 1/2, and the law of the rest will be nu. Okay, so this implies that this is absolutely continuous. Okay. And what is perhaps a bit more surprising is that it can be also singular. So it was a result by Erdős. Maybe from 39 or 40, who observed that if 1 over lambda is a Pisot number, if you don't know what a Pisot number, then I just give you an example. So say lambda equals square root of 5 over 2, the golden ratio, then nu lambda is singular. Okay? I will not give you the full proof of this, but the reason is that if you take negative powers of this number, then they will be very closely approximated by integers. This will allow you to look at the Fourier transform of the measure, and it will be a product of cosines, and somehow there will be some very bad points where these cosines are very close to one, and the product will not go to zero, and then by Riemann-Lebesgue you can conclude that the measure must be singular. Okay, today these are the only examples we know when the measure is singular. It was conjectured by Erdős that the typical behavior is that is absolute continuity, and he proved something in this direction. So I should have said that this is Erdős, although it must be clear from the date that it's not mine. Okay, so this is the same time, again due to Erdős, that there is a positive constant C such that for almost every lambda almost every lambda in the interval 1 minus C 1, nu lambda is absolutely continuous. Okay? Then this was finally proved that the typical behavior is indeed absolute continuity by Boris. I think it was 95. So basically, you can take C equals 1/2. Okay, so in the interesting interval for almost every lambda, you have absolute continuity. And very recently, this was pushed a lot further, first by Mike Hochman. Who showed that the exceptional set is even smaller, it is of zero dimension, but not quite for absolute continuity, but for the measure having full dimensions. So he proved that the set of lambdas, so lambda in the interesting interval, such that the dimension of nu lambda is strictly less than 1. This exceptional set is of packing dimension 0. And I guess this was for 2014, so the paper appeared last year.
What is the packing dimension?
I think you should ask Mike or Pablo.
It's larger or equal than Hausdorff, particularly
Hausdorff. Yeah, so this is stronger than Hausdorff. Okay. So then came Pablo. Immediately after, who improved this to nu lambda is singular is of Hausdorff dimension 0. Okay. So now we really know that the typical behavior is absolute continuity. And actually, you didn't ask what the dimension of the measure is. But basically, you can pick your favorite notion. For Bernoulli convolutions, they all coincide. So there were two in the previous lecture, and there are many more. Okay, so now the question is, what happens if I give you a specific number? Can you tell that for this specific number, the Bernoulli convolution is singular or absolute continuous? What is its dimension? Things like that. So I should first mention an old result. Which is due to Garcia. And it's from the 60s, who proved that something like, suppose lambda is algebraic, the Mahler measure of lambda is equal to 2. If you don't know what the Mahler measure is, I will later define it. The semigroup generated by X map to lambda x plus minus 1 is free, and lambda has no conjugates on the unit circle, then nu lambda is absolutely continuous. So you may wonder whether such numbers exist, but they exist. One example are the roots of 1/2, but there are actually many more. But this is still rather restrictive. And as far as I know, these are the only known examples in the literature to date. Okay, so I want to look at Bernoulli convolutions with algebraic parameter. I do it now. So let lambda be an algebraic integer. And let A0 times product x minus zj be the minimal polynomial. Of lambda, then the Mahler measure is equal to A0 times the product of the absolute value of the roots which are outside the unit circle. This is a quantity which is naturally assigned to the number lambda, and somehow it gives you some kind of one way to think about it is that you can take a suitable embedding of you look at the Bernoulli convolution into a certain number of iterations, and you look at the suitable embedding of this into a direct product of reals and complex fields, and then you will get a discrete subset of this which is contained in a box, and somehow this M lambda measures how this how the volume of this box grows. So somehow this will give you an easy upper bound on how this semigroup can grow. So it is a very relevant quantity. I define the Mahler measure for
algebraic number, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yes. I did it this way, that I put it in the product sign, under the product sign, this condition. This is an empty product, and then I have to say that the empty product is one. Yes. Thanks. Yeah, so I hope that this definition of the Mahler measure is right, but if I got it right, then the Mahler measure is the same for the number and its inverse. In any case, for most of the talk, you can pretend that lambda is an algebraic unit, and then okay. So one more. One more result. So Hochmann's methods apply to algebraic numbers, unlike what Pablo did. So in fact, from Mike's work, you can extract a dimension formula for Bernoulli convolutions with algebraic parameters, and this is again by Mike. The if lambda is algebraic, then the dimension of the Bernoulli convolution is equal to the minimum of 1 and h sub lambda over minus log lambda, where h lambda is the entropy of the random walk on the semigroup. So more formally, h lambda is equal to the limit of n goes to infinity, 1 over n, the Shannon entropy of nu lambda n, where this is the law of the first n terms in the definitions. Maybe I don't write that down. And in previous talks, it was agreed that we don't have to define Shannon entropy. So I don't do that. But I say that for the normalization, which will be important later, log is base 2. Could you say?
On the reals.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. So this is a formula for the dimension. So the first question that we need to understand is what is H lambda? And this is something that we did with Emmanuel. Maybe I should have said that h sub lambda is equal to 1 if and only if lambda is not the root of a polynomial with coefficients plus minus 1 and 0. So in fact, h lambda is 1 for a lot of examples. Actually, by the way, this is the same as the condition on Garcia's theorem that the semigroup generated by those two affine transformations is free. So if this is 1 and lambda is bigger than 1/2, then this quotient will be bigger than 1. So then you will know that the dimension of the Bernoulli convolution will be 1. So this gives you plenty of examples of Bernoulli convolutions with full dimension, but not absolute continuity. Okay, so. Yes. That's an even more concrete example. So So this is a joint work with Emmanuel Breuer. Yes. If you look tomorrow on the archive, it might be there. Okay, so what we proved is that that so the easy thing is that this is bounded above by the minimum of 1 and the logarithm of the Mahler measure. And the not so easy part is that this is bounded below by 0.4 times the same thing. Okay, so for lambda algebraic. Okay, so 1 is an obvious upper bound because the semigroup cannot go faster than 2 to the n, and log is base 2. And the Mahler measure is an upper bound because there are some number theoretic reason that I briefly indicated that it also cannot grow faster than Mahler measure to the power n. Okay, and I'm not going to talk about the proof of this result now, but I want to say a bit more about the consequences. So I remind you that there is a conjecture. Oh, maybe before I say this. So you might wonder whether this H lambda is actually equal to the upper bound. But it turns out that usually this is not the case. So we can prove that if we are in the interesting situation when the Mahler measure is less than 2 and lambda has no conjugates on the unit circle, then this inequality is strict. So in some sense, you can't really do much better than this, apart from improving on this constant. But on the other hand, you could, because this theorem in itself doesn't always tell you whether the dimension is full or not. Okay, so I remind you of this conjecture of Lehmer, which says that there is a positive constant such that the Mahler measure of any algebraic number is bigger than or equal to 1 plus this constant, or the Mahler measure is 1, which is basically the same as being a root of unity. So in particular, if lambda is less than 1, then this doesn't happen. So now if you believe this conjecture, then the consequence of this is that we have a lower bound on H sub lambda. And this implies that if lambda is sufficiently close to 1, then the dimension will be full. Okay, briefly I want to mention that this result have another application, which is not related to Bernoulli convolutions. So if S is a subset of GLN R, then define the growth rate of the semigroup generated by S as rho sub S equals the limit of n goes to infinity 1 over n times the log of the size of the n-fold product set of S. And Emmanuel had a conjecture, made a conjecture that this growth rate, well, it can be zero if the group is virtually nilpotent, because then we know that the group grows polynomially. But Emmanuel made a conjecture that this can be bounded by a constant just depending on n if it is not zero. And what we prove is that Emmanuel's conjecture is actually equivalent to Lehmer's conjecture using this these bounds. Okay, so now I will move to absolute continuity. And no, depending only on n. Depending only on n. So there is a constant which depends only on n and nothing else.
Yeah, because if you fix the degree, then of course Mahler's conjecture is true.
Yes, but n is the size of the matrices. But the entries can have algebraic numbers which come from a field of very high degree. Oh yeah. Okay. So this is this is coming later than tomorrow. So I prove that there is an absolute constant which is positive such that for all algebraic lambda with lambda is of course less than 1, but bigger than 1 minus this constant times I guess I write minimum of the log of the Mahler measure, and the log of the Mahler measure to the 10th negative power, then nu lambda is absolutely continuous. So in particular, if the Mahler measure is bounded away from 1, and it is also bounded away from infinity, then there is an interval below 1 such that for all algebraic parameters which satisfies those constraints for the Mahler measure, the Bernoulli convolution is absolute continuous. You can also figure out what happens for rational numbers. So maybe I just formulate this as a corollary. So if lambda is of the form 1 minus p over q with p less than or equal to q times log q to the 10th negative power and some constant, then nu lambda is AC. Okay, so
what other right side for Pissot.
Could you say that again?
For Pissot, we should have singularity.
Yes. So for Pissot, the Mahler measure is 1 over lambda. So basically this will fail. So that's the case when the Mahler measure is too close to 1. Okay, any questions so far? So then I want to...
Sorry, so there is a C in your general statement, but for our rationalists there is no C.
Maybe it's just not visible. Yeah. Because I put that in the last minute before. First I forgot.
Do you know? Do you have any idea?
It is an additive combinatorics type constant. So. 10 to the 10 to the 10, something like that. 1 over that, because it is small. Okay, so I wanted to say something about the proof of this result. And the proof is it uses the same strategy or very close to the strategy that Mike used in estimating the dimension of these measures. So in particular, I use entropy. And and I use the following kind of entropy. So let mu be, let X be a random variable, with low mu, and I define the entropy of mu at scale R as follows. It is an average of the Shannon entropy of the random variable scaled back by R, shifted by T, and the averaging is taking place over these random translates. So let's decipher what this means. So I'm looking at the integer part of scaling back by R inverse. So this basically means that I'm discretizing at scale R. So I take just intervals of length R, and I look at the Shannon entropy of the random variable. And I also apply this random shift with respect to which I average. And the only reason I'm doing that is because this notion this way becomes translation invariant. Okay, and furthermore, I will talk about conditional entropies, which is just formally defined as the difference of two such entropies. Okay, so now I can tell you what is the advantage of doing this averaging for translations, which is not a very important point, but it makes life easier. So you can prove that if which guy is the smaller? R is smaller, so So if you if S over R is an integer, then the entropy of a convolution cannot decrease. Okay, this is not a completely trivial statement, but I'm not going to prove it. I just wanted to mention that if you don't do this this averaging by the translation, then this is false, simply because you can convolve it by some Dirac mass and the entropy will change. Okay, so I don't know who observed this first, but it definitely appears in a paper by Zhiren Wang. Okay, so this is the quantity that I work with, and my goal is the following. My goal is to show that if I look at the conditional entropy of nu lambda at the scale 2 to the minus n, conditioned on the scale 2 to the minus n plus 1, then this is equal to 1 plus O of n to the minus 2. Okay. So if I show this, sorry? Yes, basically, depending on how you interpret that notation. But yes, one is always an upper bound. So if it is one, then it means something very strong about the measure. So if I show this, then the entropy of nu lambda at scale 2 to the minus n is equal to n minus ordo 1. And you can use this to show that nu lambda is in L log L. I think this is a general statement about measures. Basically, if the measure is singular, then it means that it somehow it concentrates on a set with small Lebesgue measure, and then you can use this discretization and show that this must be. It means that if mu lambda has a density, and if you look at this integral is finite. So it is a little bit better than absolute continuity, but really just a tiny bit. And while I'm erasing the board, I also mentioned that Pablo's method gives you a much higher regularity. I believe you can use that method to prove that you have fractional derivatives, which are absolutely continuous. Okay, so. So this is just enough to get absolute continuity.